sing something, something beautiful. I'll stand.
Good morning. How's everybody? That was terrible. That is absolutely terrible. Good morning. That is so much better. Thank you. You are actually here and awake. Thanks, God. I'm glad you're here too. I am obviously not Pastor Ricky or Pastor Mark. I know I favor Pastor Mark a little bit, but I have more hair than he does. So just thank you for being here this morning. So glad that we can come into the house of the Lord and worship as brothers and sisters in Christ. Thank you. If you are watching live stream, we're so glad that you could be with us as well. I really only have one announcement, I think. Ann, correct me if I'm wrong. She's really good at doing that. We're about to start small groups here shortly, I think in the next 2 weeks. Ann, are we going on September 12th? Is that right? For some? I told y'all she's good at that, right? She's good at correcting me, right? So I will do a shameless plug for mine. Mine is going to start September 12th, and we're going to be going through the Book of John on Zoom. So if you don't feel comfortable being in a room right now with COVID and the variant and all that kind of stuff, feel free to join us on Zoom. We'll have the login and everything on the website, and we can get it to you if we need to. Let me, let Ann know, and every morning we're going to get together. We're still going to fellowship and pray with one another, pray for the needs that we have. But we're just going to walk through John. We're going to talk about why John wrote the book of John, like he wrote it, when he wrote the book of John, all those kind of things. Because the context of the books of the Bible really, really are important. And if you were in my biblical foundations class, you know that I can nerd out on that stuff. So we're really going to have a good time walking through the book of John. And there are plenty, plenty other. We have them. They've been going on the screen, and if you noticed, it said Jonathan Watts the younger. We never want you to confuse me with the older, and so I am not the older. Although I have three kids, and I feel like they make me older every day. Some of you parents feel me on that one. But let me pray for us this morning, and we will get started. God, I just thank you for today, and I thank you for each man, woman, and child that's in here with us today. Lord, I just pray that you would take this service and do with it as you will. Use the songs to glorify your name and to praise the name of Jesus, Lord, and allow the Holy Spirit to just come in here and move in our hearts and our minds, that it would challenge us, correct us, convict us in the areas of our lives where we need to grow deeper with you and walk closer with you. And Lord, I just pray that through the word, you would just enlighten our hearts to the things of you. God, your word says that in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. So as we open the word this morning, let us be reminded that this is you that we get the privilege to dive deeply into. Father, we love you and we trust you, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the Lord. Lift high his royal banner, it must not suffer loss. From victory unto victory, his army shall he lead, till every foe is vanquished, and Christ is Lord indeed. Stand up for Jesus, the strife will not be long. This day the noise of battle, the next the victor's song. To those who vanquish evil, a crown of life shall be. He with the King of glory shall reign eternally. God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his holy Son, our Lord, who was crucified by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended unto heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, it now and ever shall be.
We are
So I want to ask you to join me in prayer this morning. And there's two things that I just want us to center our hearts and our mind on prayer this morning. Those that are about to be hit by the hurricane coming in. And that is especially close to mine and Charlotte's heart. I talked to my mom this morning. They live in South Mississippi. They live in a small little town called Foxworth where Dad's a pastor. He's about 20, 30 minutes from the Louisiana border. And Charlotte's dad and stepmom live in Pascagoula, which is right on the coast. And so don't just pray for our families, but just remember our families in your prayers. But let's pray for those that are going to be hit. I mean, it looks like it's going to be from Alabama to Louisiana, just like Katrina was. And then I want to ask you to pray for the pastors and the Christians, our military, and everyone that is in Afghanistan and over in the Middle East right now. There is so much happening there right now. I would be hard-pressed to just tell us all about it, but I'm sure you've seen the news. It's hard to turn on the news and not hear about it. So let's just for a moment remember those that serve us and serve us well, that push back the darkness in ways that we don't even know about. So pray for them. Pray for the ones that will be affected by the hurricane, and then I will pray for us. Father, you are holy and you are mighty. You are ferocious in your power, and you are incredible with your kindness and your goodness. And so, God, I just pray for those that live on the coast of Alabama, Mississippi, Louisiana. Lord, I just pray for grace and mercy over them. God, you are the one that speaks life into being. You are the one that speaks to creation. You are the one that speaks to the wind and the rain, and you just say stop, and it stops. And so, God, I pray that you would just protect those, keep those. And, Lord, for the men and women that will be responding to the emergencies, to the floods, to possibly the tornadoes, to the tidal surges, to all of those things, Lord, those caught in floods, just protect them. Give them endurance and perseverance for the days ahead. And Lord, I just pray that you would give them, the people that live there, wisdom and discernment, God, that when they need to leave, that they will leave. And God, I just pray for, first I pray for our soldiers that fight for us. In Afghanistan specifically, but all over the place, Lord, that you would protect them, that you would keep them. God, as they're facing so many unknown days and so many enemies just around every corner, Lord, that you would give them the supernatural ability to look out before them and see the enemy where they lie, Lord, and that they would be able to protect themselves, but continue to protect their brothers at arms. And Lord, we just thank you that they do things for us that we don't even know about. And God, I just thank you that we live in the United States of America. And God, that's a blessing. It is a blessing that we were just born here. And we live in a free nation. And we have a ferocious military that not only looks out for the interest of us, but looks out for the interest of the hurting and the broken around the world. And God, I just pray for the military's family, for those that have already lost a loved one, those whose loved one is probably in the hospital right now and they can't see, that your Holy Spirit would bless them, would give them a spirit of calm and comfort, and that even now, Lord, that you would reveal yourself to them as the healer of the physical needs and the emotional needs and the spiritual needs. Father, we love you and we trust you more than anything else. And if you would, join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Be strong in the Lord and be of good courage. Your defender is He who is always the same. Mount up with wings as the eagle ascending. Victory is yours when you call on His name. Be strong, be strong, be strong in the Lord, and be of good courage, for He is your guide. Be strong, be strong, be strong in the Lord, and rejoice, for the unfailing care. Trust Him, for He will be with you in battle, lighting your path to avoid every snare. Be strong, be strong, be strong in the Lord, and be of good courage, for He is your guide.
If y'all remember, I'm not going to preach from the big pulpit because that is varsity level, and I'm JV. I think you have to preach in here three times before you are on the varsity level. And this is just number two, so let's see if I can remember how to do this. Lori's not here today to help me. There we go. So first, I need to introduce myself because some of you probably don't know me. I'm Jonathan Watts. You probably know me better as Charlotte's husband, who is our children's minister. That's a great way to recognize me, but my name is Jonathan, not Charlotte's husband. But if that's what you need to go with, I've been called way worse than Charlotte's husband, so we're good there. But what I want to talk to you about this morning, the last time I was here, if you remember, I didn't have the most pleasant of sermons. Good news is today, I have a much better sermon. If you have looked at the title of the sermon, the title of the sermon is "Do You Remember Who God Is?" And if you have a pen and paper and you want to take some notes, I'm going to give you the walk away first. So if you want to write that down, and you can actually leave if you want to once I give you the walk away. Because Pastor Ricky told me I could go to 10:45. Is that about right? No? No? Everybody that goes to Sunday school is like, absolutely not. I got to get to my Sunday school. But in 1 John, usually I just want to give you a sentence to walk away with. But the Word of God, as I was studying, actually gives us a way better sentence than I could ever put together. So, if you just want to jot down the scripture reference, it's going to be 1 John chapter 4, and I'm going to start in verse 15 and read through 18. And I'm reading from the ESV, I'm teaching from the ESV. Don't freak out. Don't freak out. That's just the English Standard Version. It's just a word-by-word translation. So I just want to clarify, it's still the Bible. So don't, if you have a different translation, I'm not trying to throw you off, but just listen to the Word of God. Whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God abides in him, and he in God. So we have come to know and to believe that the love of God has for us. God is love, and whoever abides in love abides in God, and God abides in him. By this, love is perfected with us, so that we may have confidence for the day of judgment, because he is so also are we in this world. Listen to this, verse 18. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. And so the whole fixation for today's sermon is this idea of fear. This idea of fear that as Christian men and women and children, we have allowed ourselves to shrink back into fear. But we just read from the Word of God, from John, that there is no fear in this perfect love. Now, there's a Greek word for that. It's called agape, this perfect, unconditional love. And that's the way God loves you and God loves me. That's the way Jesus loved you when he went to the cross. And I just want to tell you today, brothers, sisters, we're going to be talking this morning about God being a warrior, God going before us. And I'm an athlete, and so I'm just telling you, last night I didn't sleep a whole lot because it was like the night before a football game. And I was just ready to go. Like, I almost painted my face up and brought a sword in here, and I was going to be like William Wallace just screaming freedom because I was just ready to go. I want you to be reminded of the fact that Jesus looked at Peter and he said, "This is the rock on whom I will build my church, and we will storm the gates of hell." I want to read for you real quick, because I think I just misquoted it. It's Matthew 16, verses 30 through 20. And we're going to go through a lot of scripture today. So, for those of you that did Bible drill, come on, let's go. We'll refresh our skills. But Jesus said this, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." Listen to this. The gate of hell. What do the gates of something do? It's not rhetorical. Somebody give me an answer. Gate. They what? That keeps you in. It defends. So this is not a defensive posture that Jesus is saying we're going to be in as the church. We are attacking the gates of hell. He looks at Peter. And this is the greatest part about it. He looks at Peter knowing that several chapters later he's going to betray him. He's going to deny him. And he still prophesies this over Peter. Amen? Listen, I know I'm a Baptist kid, and so I get super hyper sometimes. But if I ask for an amen, y'all got to give me some love on that. Okay? But he looks at Peter knowing that Peter is going to deny him. Deny knowing him. Be so angry that people are asking him, and be so what? Terrified to be associated with Jesus. That he denies him, but yet he still looks at Peter and says, "We will storm the gates of hell." And I want to be honest with you, brothers and sisters, we have forgotten that. and we have allowed the enemy to say things into our ears, and we have shrunk back. We have shrunk back. And so I want to lay before you today and remind you of who it is that we have given our lives to. And so I'm going to do that in 1 John. I know that the wonderful people in the booth that keep me on track are like, where is he going? Because that is not what I gave them as my scriptures to start off with. But we're going to be in 1 John. See, I'm getting there. We're going to be in 1 John chapter 3. And believe it or not, the whole idea of this sermon came from one verse. One verse. And it's in 1 John chapter 3, verse 8. And it says this: whoever makes a practice of sinning is of the devil, for the devil has been sinning from the beginning. Listen to this verse. The reason the Son of God appeared was to destroy the works of the devil. So often, around the end of the year, we get so fixated on the sweet 6-pound, 8-ounce baby Jesus, right? Right? But I need you to understand, that was a planned invasion into hostile territory. God sent His most ferocious warrior on that night in a little stable to a carpenter and to a little girl. And that is the Lion of Judah. Revelation 5:5, go read it. Says, this is the Lion of the line of Judah, the root of David. That's why when we read the lineage in Matthew 1, like, it's so important. Because it shows us where Jesus comes from. Revelation 5:5 is speaking of Jesus. He's the Lion of Judah. Ferocious. Now listen, what I want to do, because I think we get confused when we think of lions, I'm not talking about Simba in The Lion King. I'm not talking about a cartoon character. I'm not talking about a lion at the zoo. Right? We're not really scared of a lion at the zoo, right? Because we're safe. It's behind bars or behind this really weird plexiglass material that I still don't really trust. I'm talking about a ferocious lion on the savannah of Africa. We're not going out there, right? Nobody's going out to the place where the lion is king and going up to him and slapping him in the face, right? No, the closest we're going to get is to like an armored jeep, in which we may look, even in the jeep, from like 100 yards away. Why? Because that's real power, right? That's an apex predator. Have you ever watched the Discovery Channel of what that thing will do to a zebra or a wildebeest? Like, it ain't pretty. And I'm not even squeamish, but that ain't pretty. Why? Because he's ferocious in power. And that's what we're talking about this morning. I want to ask you to pray with me real quick. And if you remember me from the last time, I want you to bow your head and close your eyes. This is not a magical way that God hears you, but I just want you to, for a moment, just forget who you're sitting beside. Parents, you may want to put your hand on your kid to make sure they don't run away. But I just want you to ask the Holy Spirit, what do I need to hear from you this morning? What do you have for my heart? What do you have for my mind? And then next, I want to ask you to pray for me. If I'm really honest with you, I'm a bit distracted because I'm worried about my mom and my dad. I'm worried about my father-in-law. But I want you to pray for me that my mind and my heart would be singularly focused on proclaiming the Word of God, because I truly believe in my spirit this is a word that we as the body here at First United Methodist have got to proclaim to our community. Well, Father, we love you and we trust you. Do with this time as you will. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Speaking of which, I think my mom's watching. Mom, I love you. So what does this mean for us? We want to talk about God being a warrior. Well, I want to give you some verses. I really could give you like just this extended list of verses, but I'm only going to give you three from the Old Testament just to give you an example of what I'm talking about. Exodus 15:3 says this, "The Lord is a man of war. The Lord is his name." Isaiah 42, if you want to flip there real quick. If not, it's great. I'm going to read it to you. The Lord goes out like a mighty man, like a man of war. He stirs up his zeal. He cries out. He shouts out. He shows himself mighty against his foes. Zephaniah 3:17. Now this one may take me a minute. So you're hearing the pattern here, right? That's Zechariah. Zephaniah, there we go. 3:17. There's this repeated pattern over and over and over again. The Lord your God is in your midst, a mighty one who will save. He will rejoice over you with gladness, and he will quiet you by his love. Now, I know we don't have a children's minute right now, but I want to talk to my kids in the room. And you're, guess what? You're allowed to respond back. Parents, don't discipline them right now, okay? Kids in the room, I'm speaking to you. Who do you think of when you think of somebody that is strong? Who? Was that Cam? Oh, Evie. Who? Jesus? That was a great Sunday school answer. Yes, sir. Jesus? We got some good kids that are already listening to the sermon. Yes, ma'am. Jesus, we're on a roll. Any parents want to help me out with a not Sunday school answer? When you think of some, yes. Hulk, thank you. There we go. When we think of this idea of strength and power, guess what we think of? We think of movies like The Avengers. We think of Superman, which, by the way, it's hilarious that the secular world has created this idea of Superman. And if you ever just want to go and study who Superman is, it almost mirrors Jesus Christ exactly. Isn't that interesting? They say they don't want to believe in Jesus Christ, but guess what? They want a hero. Amen? Thank you for that. And I got the opportunity to sit with some men on Wednesday morning. And I just started with this idea of where I think we are in 2020 when we think about good versus evil. Anybody remember the symbol of yin and yang? You don't have to shout out at me. You can just give me a hand. By the way, I'm trying to be interactive so I make sure that you're awake. Okay? So we have this big circle, right? And there's like a S kind of, I'm not going to draw it with my fingers, I promise. But there's this like S down the middle, and one side is black, one side is white. There's a little dot of white on one side, there's a little dot of black. And I think this is how we view the struggle between God and Satan. And can I tell you something? That ain't it. That is not it at all. Satan, who rules over hell and all of his demons, is not close to our God. You go and read the book of Job in the first two chapters, what does the devil have to do? He has to come and present himself before God and ask permission and get God's permission to go do anything to Job. And I want you to pay attention to what God says. God says in the first chapter, he says, you can go and strike everything that he has, but on the man, you can do nothing. How's that go? He can't touch the man. Right? He doesn't touch the man. Why? Because God told him he couldn't. In the second chapter, God says, all right, you can touch the man. You can give him sickness. You can give him disease. You can give him all that. But you shall not take his life. What does the devil do? He goes and does all this stuff to his body, gives him diseases, gives him these I don't even know what they were. But they're so bad that he takes a broken piece of pottery and is just scraping his arm. I'm sorry if I'm being a little... But that's what the Bible says, okay? So don't get mad at me. Be mad at God. That's his word, not what I'm saying. All right? But what does Satan... He can't take his life. Why? Because God has spoken, and that is what will happen. That's who we serve. That is the name of our God. Power. Might. The same God that spoke light into existence just by his sheer word. And I want you to understand this. How do we know what light is in the universe? Anybody tell me? Where does our light come from? The sun. A star, right? God speaks light into existence before he ever creates stars. Don't believe me? Go read Genesis. Now, isn't that something to think about? That he speaks light into existence. Light comes into the universe before stars ever do. You know why? Because God is not bound by our universe. He created our universe. This is the God that we serve. We have nothing to fear. The victory's already won. The victory's already won. You know when the victory was won? Genesis 3. After God has given all of these consequences out, he says this in verse 15. He says, I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and her offspring, and he shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. You know what he's speaking about right there? He's saying, guess what, serpent? I'm going to send my son through this line, and he's going to destroy you. Yes, you're going to bruise him. Yes, you're going to torment him. But at the end of the day, he's going to crush your head, and he will be victorious. That's in the beginning. It's in the very beginning. There's plenty of passages all throughout the Bible. When Jesus goes to the tombs, y'all remember the story of Jesus coming into contact with the demons and he puts them in the pig? Puts them in the pigs, plural, not the pig. Puts them in the pigs. They run out of the tombs to Jesus and they say, O Son of Man, they know who they're speaking to. They fall down before the presence of God. They say, O Son of Man, have you come to torment us before the appointed time? They knew they were going to get destroyed. They just thought it was going to be later. Amen? Guys, we have to remember who it is that we have given our lives to. I don't have to fear anything. I don't have to fear disease, death, right? Jesus conquered the grave. He conquered death on the resurrection. Which, by the way, I think we need to preach a whole lot more than Easter Sunday. Because the cross saved us from something. The grave and the resurrection saved us to something. And Jesus stands victorious over sin and death. Y'all, really? I didn't get an amen on that? Really? Thank you very much. Glad our kids are paying attention. But this is what I want you guys to understand. And listen, I'm not even talking about COVID. You know what? I'm just going to be honest with you. Whatever your conscience tells you to do, do it. And can I speak to everybody else in the room? Leave people alone. They want to get the shot, let them get the shot. They want to wear a mask, let them wear a mask. You want to get the shot? You don't want to get the shot? Whatever. Guess what? You're still my brother or sister in Christ. I'm going to respect you. I'm not speaking about that this morning. I'm speaking about things like Afghanistan. My brothers and sisters, my pastors in Afghanistan that are ferociously preaching the gospel because they know who Jesus is, they know who Father is, they know who the Holy Spirit is, and they say, yes, I may be beheaded, yes, my whole family may be killed, but I know where my victory is, I know where my victory lies, and I'm going to proclaim truth. I got the privilege in 2016 to go to India and teach pastors for about 2-3 weeks. And at the end of every time I got done, I asked my translator if I could just hear from these pastors and hear these stories. And I still have some on my phone. I listened to them and I sent a video to the men I got to sit with on Wednesday. And you listen to these stories. And I'm telling you, I was like, why am I teaching these guys? These guys need to be teaching me. I heard from a man who when he was preaching the gospel, first, he was rejected by his family. Now, in the Indian culture, when you are rejected by your family, there is no reconciliation. That does not happen unless your family gets saved. Does not happen. There's no, when your dad says that you are dismissed from the family, that's it. So he's dismissed from his family. So there's no inheritance there. There's no, like, he can't see his aunts, uncles, cousins, nobody. He was preaching the gospel in the street, and some men came up and beat him so bad that he had to go to the hospital. While he's in the hospital, they go to his place of business, and they completely destroy the business to where it's absolutely gone. So he's in the hospital trying to recover, and now he's actually lost the way he's going to provide for his family. You know what he does the first day he gets out of the hospital? He goes right back to the same street and proclaims the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now let me ask you this question, and this question is to me too. I'm telling you, this message, studying for this one, has got me fired up. When's the last time you proclaimed the gospel of Jesus? Yeah, I didn't think I was going to get an amen on that one. When? You proclaim the name of Jesus. I would argue that I could go around this room, and there's probably not anyone that would be willing to say, I'm not a Christian. So we carry the name of Christ. 2 Corinthians 5 says that he is making his appeal through us. We are his ambassadors. But yet we keep our mouths closed. Why? Because we're scared of somebody thinking we're a Christian? Because we're scared somebody's going to call us the Bible guy or the Bible woman? Can I just tell you, that's like a good thing to be called, right? And I'm not telling you, like, you have to stand up on a street corner with a microphone and read Revelation to people and talk about hell and damnation till the cows come home. I'm just talking about the people that you come into contact with, your kids, your family members. Have you told people about what Jesus has done in your life without fear? The enemy will make us so afraid. When I was in Pascagoula and I was a student pastor down there, how's my time going? We put note cards in the seat because we were preaching on fear. And we asked, we said, why is it that you don't want to share the gospel with people? And then we asked them to come forward and lay those cards down and be able to rise up and go and proclaim the gospel and leave those fears here. You know what the majority of those cards said? I'm scared. I'm scared. And I'm just here to tell you, you have nothing to be scared about. Nothing. I'm not telling you that you have to go and preach a Bible study or that. I will say this for Anne. She would love it if you would teach a Bible study. But I'm just saying, tell your story boldly and proudly. Your story doesn't look like mine. But somebody needs to hear your story. You were saved for a reason and a purpose. And if you look at me, brother, sister, and you say, my relationship with God is my relationship with God, I will look at you and I will say, there is not a biblical aspect of that statement. That's nowhere in the Bible. Matthew 28, we get the Great Commission. Acts 1, Jesus says, you will go and be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. In earth. Singular, not plural. There's only one on earth. But he's saying to his people, you will go and you will testify to who I am and what I will do in your life. I'm getting close to being done, I promise. I'll get you to your Sunday school classes on time, even if we have to sing through the last song in fast forward. I want you to think about this for a second. The story of David. I got 5 minutes, I think. We'll see. The story of David. David is probably 13-year-old, 14-year-old boy, mining sheep, youngest of his brothers. Mom says, hey, your brothers have been gone for a long time. You probably need to bring them food. Go take them food. I'm sure it was probably not a yes, ma'am, and go and bring them food. It was probably a fight. for anybody that has kids that are my age. My kid's age, not my age. So he brings them food, and while he's giving them food, he hears this Philistine mocking the God of Israel and mocking his armies. And he steps up and he just says, "What are y'all doing?" And this is the Jonathan Watts paraphrase. "What are y'all doing? If none of y'all will go fight this guy, I'm going to go fight this guy. This 13-year-old. And here's the crazy thing about it. The army and the king of Israel let him. Right? They let the 13-year-old go against the giant. Let me ask you this. If you have a 13-year-old and there's a giant outside and he's proclaiming harassing statements against the name of God, you going to let your 13-year-old go fight him? I'm not letting Dallas go fight him. When Dallas doesn't have his medicine, he's a little squirrely, but I ain't letting him go fight a giant. I'm going to go fight the giant." So what does that tell you about King Saul and the nation of Israel? They were absolutely petrified. And I love what David says. "You come at me with javelin and sword, and I come at you with the name of the Lord God Almighty." And that 13-year-old, not only, and I'm giving you the Bible version of what he does to Goliath. He not only knocks him down with a rock to the forehead, he runs over there like a warrior and cuts his head off with Goliath's sword. Goliath's sword was probably as big as David. And then what does the army of the Philistines do? They run from a 13-year-old. The same God that was with David is the same God that will be with you today. Come on now. I'm going to do it again. The same God that was with the 13-year-old boy that killed the giant and made a whole army run is the same God that will be with you in 2021. Thank you. Men and women, we have got to rise up and carry the banner of hope to our communities, to our families, because only in doing that will we push back the darkness that has broken the hearts of so many. And I'm begging you, as your brother in Christ, let's get to work. Let's get to work. Pray with me. God, thank you for today. And I thank you for who you are. And I thank you for what you do in our lives. And God, I just ask you to be with us, to keep us, to watch over us. Lord, let us not go out here this morning and think about just food. Let us keep our hearts and our minds fixated on being the people that you've called us and you've saved us and you've equipped us to be. And that is some ferocious warriors for the name of God. Father, we love you and we trust you. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And before we sing, I just want to say the altar is here. Please come and kneel and pray if you need to. I'll be right here. If you would like me to pray with you, I would love to pray with you. But let's not stay in our seats if the Lord is calling us to do something. You can't go to war if you've got a ball and a weight around your ankle. So if you need to lay some things down this morning, let's lay some things down this morning. Thank you.
Let's get to your feet, please.
Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee. Thank you.
Thank y'all. Not really sure how this works out, and you may have to give me a hand on how we do the offering, because I'm pretty sure I'm going to get in big trouble if we don't pass the offering plate. We do it as we leave. Okay. Woo! Y'all, remember, I'm a Southern Baptist preacher's kid. We don't have service unless the offering plate gets passed around. All right? So I want to pray for us. Pastor Ricky told me I'm supposed to raise a plate. Is that right? Yeah, no, I got one over here. Listen, I'm learning JV, right? I'm going to learn it the third time. Y'all are going to be like, is that Pastor Mark? But I just want to say thank y'all for letting me be with you this morning. It is a blessing to me every time I get to stand up and proclaim the Word of God. But it is a blessing to me to be able to do it here with a family that has loved us well. We have so much loved our time here. We live far away from our family. And so when we say things like your family, we mean that. So thank y'all so much. I mean that. I'm not going to get emotional. Because I can be, but I won't get emotional now. So are we singing? Are we playing? We're playing, aren't we, Miss Susan? Okay. Let's pray. God, thank you for today. And Lord, we thank you for the provision that you give us. And Lord, I just pray for the tithes and the offerings. Lord, we just pray that they would be used to glorify your name, and that we would make much of who you are here in Gunnersville and in Marshall County, in the places that we work, in the homes that we represent. And God, that we would find ways to serve this community well and serve each other, love each other. Father, we love you and we trust you. Thank you for what you bless us with. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
All right, let's go and be some warriors, right? Right? I like that, Rod. Thank you.